Hello everyone, welcome to Analog IAS Current Affairs Analysis for 30th December 2019. These are the articles that we'll be dealing today. The first article for the day is taken from The Hindu and it is titled For a Humane and Autonomous Police. Recently, there were violent protests against the Citizenship Amendment Act after it was passed in the Parliament. Now, these protests that took to the streets, the debate that could have happened in the Parliament saw a rise in violence. As a result, the police had to use their discretionary powers to maintain law and order. As a part of this, the police were forced to enter the Jamia Islamia University and various other universities to maintain law and order. In this scenario, there were arguments that police cannot enter universities and universities should allow police into their campuses only when there is a written order or a request from the administration of the college. However, the author of this article, who happens to be a former director of the Central Bureau of Investigation, feels this is a shallow argument. The police, whether it is on the campus or outside, cannot resort to taking orders from ministers or executive when the question of law enforcement comes into the picture. In this context, the author quotes the example of an English jurist who said the same thing, that the responsibility of law enforcement is on the police. He is answerable to the law and the law alone. And the situation in India is also different, and it is not different from the English scenario. The second complaint against the way police handled was the measure of force. It was alleged that police resorted to some very violent methods, and the author of this article tries to defend this by saying that mob control techniques are a part of the police curriculum. So, depending upon the level of protest and the methods employed by the protesters, the police have the discretion to use the resources at their dispensal to handle such mobocracy. In a democracy like ours, it is important to note the fact that an equally potent force is required to handle such violent protests. Right to dissent is a part of a democratic institution, and at the same time, law enforcement is also a part of the institution. So, violence cannot be a substitute for dissent. There is a crucial need for senior police officers to devote time to improve the quality of policing in this field. That is the need of the hour, rather than managing their political bosses, according to the author. The next article for the day is titled Governance Index, and this is from The Hindu. Good Governance Day is observed on the birth anniversary of former Prime Minister Shri Atal Bihari Vajpayee, whose birthday happens to be on 25th December. So, it was observed for the very first time in 2014. On this occasion, the central government came up with a good governance index to have a look at the various indicators of governance and how different states are performing on this. So, what is this good governance index? It is basically a tool which assesses the status of governance and the impact of various interventions that a state takes up on its citizens. So, what are the objectives of this? First one is to provide quantifiable data. Secondly, it is to enable states and union territories to formulate and implement suitable strategies for improvement of governance. Thirdly, it is to shift towards result-oriented approaches and administration. The Good Governance Index takes into consideration 10 governance structures, which are further divided into 50 indicators. These indicators are given different weightage, and one governance sector is calculated as per that weightage. In this edition, Tamil Nadu stood at the first position as the best governed state. The interesting fact is that the erstwhile Bimaru states, which are considered to be very less developed, take the case for example of Rajasthan, out of the 10 sectors, it stood in top 10 in at least 5 sectors. So, the states are catching up. However, any index of this nature will have some problems in its inaugural version. Now let us have a look at what these are. Certain parameters like farmers' income, micro-irrigation, water conservation models, and inflow of investment into industries has been completely ignored. And also there is the second issue of the weightage given to ease of doing business. It has been alleged that the weightage given is too high for this. Despite these shortcomings and the fact that there is scope for improvement, we cannot take away the strength of this work and we can only build on this work. We have to keep in mind the India's size and complexity when carrying out works like this. So it is with appreciation that we have to move forward, and such seminal work should be celebrated as they result in overall good governance. The next article for the day is taken from the Hindu and it is titled India Needs a Bottom-Up Growth Model. In general, there are two kinds of economic development theories. One is the bottom-up approach and the other one is the top-down approach. Let us have a look at how we look at growth. Economic growth is considered to be the prerequisite for economic development. Now, when we are focusing all our policies on growth, this is how it becomes. The smaller circle on growing becomes a bigger circle. But it need not necessarily translate into equitable distribution of resources. As seen in the present case, where 1% of the population owns a majority of the wealth and rest of the 99% population holds very little amount of wealth. This is the consequence of unequal distribution of resources and will generally lead to inequality. This rise of inequality is a problem. Now, let us have a look at the approach for development. The first one is the top-down model, where states and the center act together to make the lives of citizens better. And there is this people-centric approach called the bottom-up approach, which is considered to be the most sustainable way of growing. To compare and contrast, India and China, which have had similar levels of human development indicators 3 or 4 decades ago, China now has much better indicators. This is because of the local level governance, where people-centric governance took precedence over growth-centric governance. In India, states have different models of governance. We see coexistence of various kinds of governance models within our states itself. For example, you have Kerala, where people-led government and the people-led governance systems has led to better human development indicators, yet low per capita incomes when compared to some other well-to-do states. On the other hand, we have Gujarat, where growth is seen as the forerunner for every other economic policy, and yet we have a lot of malnourished kids dying out of hunger. In the present scenario, we also have the case of Delhi, where pro-people governance has been taking the agenda of the present Aam Aadmi Party's government forward. There are various cases where democracy has seen its true spirit in the form of school management committees or in the public service delivery aspect. There has been substantial increase in piped water from 55% to 95% in just 5 years. And there has been expanded electricity supply, which increased customer base by more than 20% even in unauthorized colonies. So this is the example for people-centric governance. Some government estimates quote that nearly 4,000 rupees per month were being saved by citizens because of the timely delivery of public services, which roughly translates into 24,000 crores per annum. So this shows how people-centric governance will reap benefits and show the true democratic spirit in our country. In the present economic slowdown and the contrasting trends of withdrawal from multilateralism and at the same time voices within the country advocating more free trade as seen in the form of regional comprehensive economic partnership, we have to focus all our policies on one fulcrum, We have to take the example of Gandhi's talisman, which speaks about policies helping the poorest of the poor man. So that should be the focus of policy makers, and we should focus on ease of living. So there can be the coexistence of two paradigms. One is the ease of doing business, which speaks about governance, and the other, which is ease of living, which guides the policy principles. That is the gist of this article. The next article for the day is taken from Indian Express, and it is titled Not a Drop to Waste. This is in the context of the recently launched Atal Bhujal Yojana, which is seen as a first step towards recharging groundwater levels. What was the need for introducing a new scheme to deal with groundwater? Firstly, historically, we have mismanaged our groundwater, and the groundwater resources have continuously depleted. Secondly, there is no participatory governance. What do you mean by participatory governance? Whether it is in the realm of policy making or in the arena of implementing the policy, there was no involvement of the locals. This has led to mismanagement between the needs as well as the demands of that particular area. Thirdly, there are historically many improper policies like subsidized electricity and free power to farmers, which led to unregulated usage of groundwater levels. To corroborate the same facts, we have the Central Water Management Index of Niti Aayog, which says that 70% of our water resources are polluted. And according to another Niti Aayog report, by 2020, 21 Indian cities, including metros like Delhi, Chennai and Bangalore, will run out of groundwater. So in this scenario, Atal Bhujal Yojana became an imperative. The positives of this scheme is that the scheme is trying to address the institutional deficiencies and the managerial issues within the governance framework. Secondly, it is trying to change the behavior of the people by creating awareness about the importance of conserving groundwater. But the fact that it is implemented only in 7 states. Now, this can be a prelims question. If the statement is Atal Bhujal Yojana will be implemented across India, it is false as of now. Unless and until the government notifies, please remember this step. So this point is a reminder that this is only a first step towards a long-term solution. It is not that we didn't have any other scheme or policy to address groundwater, but its implementation was bad. So Atal Bhujal Yojana will do well to utilize the already existing resources, especially in the terms of institutions. The most important institution created by the erstwhile scheme, which is called the Groundwater Management and Regulation Scheme, mentions something called the Water User Associations, which is a community where the users of the water resources are themselves made a part of the decision-making structure. Now, the real challenge for this scheme lies in empowering these associations, and given the fact that politically incorrect decisions like metering the electricity used by farmers is too big to be asked from political parties, we might try out certain other case studies where farmers are incentivized for saving electricity and eventually phasing out the electricity subsidy. Whenever we talk about groundwater management, the political parties either talk about metering the fields of farmers, or they talk about how high electricity subsidy will cause depletion of groundwater. The narrative should move beyond these two points. So they should actually try to work out solutions and ensure that groundwater, which is responsible for 60% of the irrigation resources, is conserved properly. That is what this article is trying to say. The last article for the day is taken from Live Mint, and it is titled Electricity Key to a Nation's Development. The 7th Sustainable Development Goal talks about accessible energy, which is very reliable, affordable, and is very qualitative. Secondly, it also emphasizes that there shall be a greater emphasis on renewable energy, and at the same time the efficiency of the electronic devices is doubled. So in this context, what is India's performance and what is the importance of electricity for the transformation of a country is the key gist of this article. Now, the definition of electrification as per the government's rule is, if the government ensures that every village basic infrastructure in the form of the panchayat office or schools gets the power, and at least 10% of the household gets power, that village is said to be electrified. Now, we have achieved the target last year. However, it has been a point of debate. We also have to note that our government is trying to achieve 100% household electrification through its Saubhagya program. The need of the hour right now is reliability, affordability and quality, the next three aspects of the sustainable development goals. However, the issue is the states don't have enough resources to invest in infrastructure of electricity generation as well as electricity distribution. States might at max give some investment subsidies for starting or to provide access. However, states are underpowered to ensure reliability, affordability as well as quality. Even the DISCOMs are willing to underinvest only, but not invest according to the needs of the village because of the low subsidies given by the government as well as low revenues. So, despite the fact that government has invested heavily on DISCOMs, which are facing a lot of issues, and despite the fact that state governments have borne the burden through Uday scheme, the health of DISCOMs is still under scrutiny. So, the urgent need is to address the problems of DISCOMs to ensure that there is a stable and reliable electricity supply, because electricity access in a way is central to the concept of well-being of its citizens. That's it for the day. Thank you.